والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون، والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون، والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون، إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين، فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون، والذين هم لأماناتهم وعهدهم راعون، والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون، أولئك هم الوارثون، الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون. صدق الله العظيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم. صلاة وسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. First of all, this surah is known as Surah Al-Mu'minun, and the reason for this name is because in the very first verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the believers and He says قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, the believers have prospered. And so based on that, this surah has been given the name Surah Al-Mu'minun. And it has been referred to as Surah Al-Mu'minun in certain narrations. The Prophet ﷺ recited from Surah Al-Mu'minun. He began from the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun until where in this surah it mentions Sayyidina Harun and Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam and Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the Prophet ﷺ. At that point he developed a cough and so he went into ruku, and that's narrated in Sahih Muslim. In addition to this, Sayyidina Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, he narrates that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent revelation, the sound that we heard was like the humming of bees. And one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent revelation, and so this tells us that the Sahaba, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received wahi and revelation, they did actually, they knew, many of them actually realized, they saw the telltale signs and they realized that this, at this moment in time, wahi and revelation is being sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so on this occasion he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent wahi to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we saw for a short while that same, you know, the description of those event Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending a revelation, we saw them for a short while and then they went away. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he raised his hands and he turned towards the Qibla and he prayed and he said, oh Allah, give us more and don't withhold from us. Oh Allah, give us respect and honor and don't dishonor us. Oh Allah, give to us and don't deprive us. Oh Allah, give us priority. Don't give others priority over us. Oh Allah, be pleased with us and please us. And so the Prophet ﷺ then said, he said, I have just been given 10 verses. Whoever acts upon these 10 verses, he will undoubtedly enter Jannah. And so the Prophet ﷺ then recited these 10 verses, the first 10 verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun. And inshallah, in these 9 or 10 days, our focus will be these first 11 verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun, because the 10 verses, they define their qualities and attributes of the believers. The 11th verse actually tells us the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them. And so we'll be focusing on these first 11 verses. If we manage to finish them, then inshallah we can move on and look at the rest of this surah as well. But our focus, main focus, will be these first 11 verses of this surah. Sayyidina Anas bin Malik, and that hadith of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala is narrated by Imam Tirmidhi, amongst many others, is narrated by Imam Tirmidhi in his Sunnah. And Sayyidina Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the garden of Adam, Jannah, or Jannatu Adam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the gardens of Adam, He created trees within those gardens. And to these gardens of paradise and these trees of paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded, He said, read. He said, read or recite or speak. And these trees, when they received this command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. So the trees of Jannah recited the opening verse of this surah, Surah Al-Mu'minun. And that's narrated by Imam Hakim in his Mustadrak. Yazid bin Babinus, he narrates that we asked Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, O mother of believers, what was the conduct and character of the Messenger of Allah like? And Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, this is a very famous hadith. Undoubtedly, every one of you will have heard this hadith. She responded and she said, Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an. The conduct and the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the Qur'an. Or the teachings of the Qur'an, they were, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an embodiment of the teachings of the Qur'an. That was his conduct, that was his character. Now this much is very, very famous, and you know, almost everybody's heard that much, and they know that hadith, many will know the wording as well, Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an. But that's not the complete and the entire narration. This hadith actually continues. And what many people won't know is that this hadith continues, and there's actually a very important section of this hadith which Imam Nasa'i is narrating in his Sunan that is often not narrated as part of the narration that people frequently narrate, which is what? Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, she said his conduct was the Qur'an, but she didn't stop there. After saying that, Sayyidina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she began to recite, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And she recited all 10 verses, all of the 10 beginning verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun. And after reciting them, she said, this was the conduct of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she actually specified, you know, where it says Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, that his conduct was the Qur'an, she actually specifies which verses she's talking about in particular. Yes, the Prophet ﷺ was an embodiment of all the entire Qur'an and all its rulings, but in particular, she on this occasion, she specifies these 10 verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun, and she says, this is what the conduct of the Prophet ﷺ was. So this is related by Imam Nasa'i in his Sunan, and also Tabaqat of Imam Ibn Sa'd and Mustadrak of Imam Hakim. They narrate this complete narration in which she actually mentioned that she recites these verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun. This is, it shows you some of the importance of the first 10 verses of this surah. not that any verse of the Quran is unimportant, but some verses have more of a significance or a particular relevance than others. And so it shows you how important these 10 verses are. And there's actually a special and specific significance attached to the last few verses of this surah as well, which inshallah, even if we don't get through the whole surah, but towards the end of our discussions, I will touch upon the last four verses, again, have a very special significance of this surah as well. And so inshallah, we'll touch upon that when we finish our discussion on the first 10 verses as well. So when was this verse actually revealed? It is agreed upon that this surah was revealed in Makkah Mukarramah, 13 years after the first revelation or announcement of the Prophet. So this was very, very close to the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was revealed in the 13th year after the announcement of the prophethood or the declaration, the first revelation, Ba'tha, however you want to refer to it. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he accepted Islam in the 6th year after the announcement of prophethood. And we have seen that in Tirmidhi, there are several narrations which actually talk about Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala telling us what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experienced when revelations were sent to him. And it also mentions Surah Al-Mu'minun as well. And so it actually tells us, so let me just recap on that, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Makkah for 13 years after the announcement of prophethood. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he accepted Islam in the 6th year after prophethood. So that means, because we have narrations narrated by Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala which mention this surah, we can quite clearly state that it wasn't revealed in the first 6 years, but it was revealed in Makkah. And so it was revealed from the 7th year, between the 7th year and the 13th year in Makkah al-Mukarramah. So around the middle of the Makkan period, this surah was revealed. So not in the 13th year, but in fact, between the 7th and the 13th year, this surah was revealed. And it mentions, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ. That's one of these first verses, that those who pay their zakat, those who pay their charity. And zakat, charity, was obligated in Medina Munawwara. And so, charity was obligated in Makkah Mukarramah. This also tells us, the charity being obligated in Medina Munawwara, this tells us that this surah should have been revealed in Medina Munawwara. So, zakat as well as prayer towards the end of the Makkah period, fasting in the 2nd year after Hijrah, zakat after that. Zakat was actually obligated after the Hijrah in the Madani period. So this tells us that this surah should have been revealed in the Madani period. And so we can see that there's a difference between the narrations, and it's difficult to pinpoint the precise time of revelation of this surah. In addition to this, this surah and its blessings and virtues are many. We'll move on to the surah itself and start looking at some of the verses. That's a brief introduction to the surah, some of the virtues we mentioned. In particular, that these 10 or 11 verses define the conduct and character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as defined by Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala in her hadith, that kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, that the conduct of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the Qur'an. So how does this surah begin? I want to begin by reciting to you these 11 verses and giving you, first of all, just a translation of these 11 verses. And so we'll look at the translation, and then we'll come back and look in detail at some commentary on each one of these verses. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد أفلح المؤمنون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that indeed the believers have prospered. الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون. Those who are sincere in their prayers. So who are these believers? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their characteristics. Those who are sincere in their prayers.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ.
Those who stay away from, those who stay clear from, turn their faces away from that which is useless.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ.
Those who pay their zakat, who pay the obligatory charity.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ.
Those who protect their modesty, those who protect their chastity. And the word furuj is used, which means your private regions, those who protect them, in other words, those who protect their modesty and their chastity.
Illa ala azwajihim aw ma malakat aymanuhum fa innahum ghayru madumin.
So they protect their chastity and their modesty, except when it comes to their wives or those that their right hands possess, in other words, slaves. فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ. Then they are not blameworthy in any way. Right? So they only fulfill their desires through halal means. That's what it's essentially saying there.
فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى وَرَاءَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ.
Whoever seeks beyond this, then فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْعَادُونَ, then it is those people who have transgressed. So you have halal means of satisfying your desires, which is through marriage and nikah, and beyond that, anyone who goes beyond that is crossing limits.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ.
Those who are mindful of items that are entrusted to them, amanat, and their promises, ahd. So, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ. Those who are mindful of items that are entrusted to them and their promises. In other words, they uphold their promises and they do not violate the trust of any item that is entrusted to them.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ.
And those who safeguard their prayers. And note that the prayer is mentioned twice in these 10 verses. The second verse says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. That those who have sincerity in their prayers. And then verse number 9 as well.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ.
Those who safeguard their prayers. So, safeguarding the prayers and also adopting sincerity in the prayers.
أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ.
They are the inheritors. These are those 10 verses which Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha refers to as the conduct and character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are inheritors. Inheritors of what?
الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسِ.
those who inherit or who will inherit Jannatul Firdaus.
Hum fiha khalidun.
And they shall remain there forever. So that's a translation, a simple translation of those 11 verses. Now the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about here is قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, that the believers have prospered. And the word that is used is أَفْلَحَ, and this comes from the Arabic root of فَلَاح, which means prosperity and success. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines here parameters of success. The very first thing that we need to understand is that the parameters of success that are given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may be very much different to the parameters of success that we have set for ourselves in the world. We think that having a good job, nice home, good car, a family, and everything else that we require is prosperity, and that is success. When in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the successful are those who become the inheritors of Jannatul Firdaus. Put these two statements together, you have falah, because our standard of falah, and what a lot of people consider to be their standard of prosperity, is related solely and purely to the dunya. Everything that you earn here is going to perish along with you. And the fact is that every single person on the Day of Judgment, Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she narrates, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that on the Day of Judgment, everybody will be resurrected unclothed, and the way they were created originally by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way they were born. And Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked this, the Prophet ﷺ this question. And this is something that's quite remarkable about Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha. Her readiness to ask the Prophet ﷺ questions. And a great deal of our deen, we know because of the questions that she asked the Prophet ﷺ. That's why she's this is such a remarkable woman. And you know, it's no wonder then that she was extremely intelligent, but as well as being intelligent, she was very inquisitive as well. And she was asking, she was able to ask questions without any sort of fear or without holding back at all. And she was able to then deliver the response of those questions to the rest of the Sahaba. And so she asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She said, "Ya Rasulullah sallam." And perhaps the thought that came into her mind, or maybe the thought that may have come into some of your minds, which is that Islam places such a huge emphasis on modesty and covering yourself and keeping your aura concealed, and then on the Day of Judgment everybody will be resurrected without any clothes on. What's the wisdom behind that? The fact is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran as well that you will be resurrected the way you were originally created, the way you were born. You will be resurrected in that state, but then one by one, people will gradually be clothed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His mercy. And Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked, she said, "Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if everyone is unclothed, then won't people see each other's aura, and will their modesty not be exposed to everybody?" And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her, he said, "Aisha, with the difficulties of that day, no one will realize that they themselves or anyone else is unclothed." Pretty khas baat hai. Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha ne poocha, ye baat ye arz kar raha tha ki fala ka jo humne mayar rakha hai, uska to taluq sirf duniya ke saath. دنیا سے تو ہر کسی نے جانا ہے اور جو کچھ ہے سارا کچھ چھوڑ کے جانا ہے. یہاں تک کہ جب قبروں سے لوگ اٹھیں گے تو ننگے پاؤں ننگے سر اور بدن پر کپڑے بھی نہیں ہوں گے. جس طرح پہلی حیث میں دنیا میں آئے تھے اسی حیث میں اٹھائے جائیں گے. تو سید عائشہ صدیقہ رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اس حدیث مبارکہ کی راویہ ہے. وہ فرماتی ہے کہ میں نے پھر پوچھا, اور یہ سیدہ عائشہ صدیقہ رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ کا اعزاز ہے کہ انہوں نے سوالات پوچھے اور ان کے سوال پوچھنے کی وجہ سے بہت سا علم امت کو حاصل ہوا ہے. اگر آپ کو سوال نہ پوچھتی تو وہ جواب بھی نہ ملتے اور وہ علم اس علم سے امت محروم رہ جاتی. تو یہ ان کا بہت بڑا ایک خدمت ہے علم کے حوالے سے. آج بعض کلچر اور بعض لوگ ایسے ہیں جو اسلام کے نام پر یہ کہتے ہیں کہ خواتین کو علم سکھانا ہی نہیں چاہیے, حالانکہ سیدہ عائشہ صدیقہ رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اس امت کی استاد ہیں. تو آپ فرماتی ہیں کہ میں نے پھر پوچھا, میں نے کہا یا رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, اگر سارے لوگ بغیر کپڑوں کے اٹھائے جائیں گے تو کیا ہر کسی کا ستر کھلا ہوا نہیں ہوگا, شرمگاہیں کھلی نہیں ہوگی, ستر کھلا نہیں ہوگا؟ تو نبی کریم صلی اللہ تعالیٰ علیہ وسلم نے ارشاد فرمایا کہ عائشہ اس دن کی ہولناکیاں ایسی ہوں گی کہ نہ کسی کو اپنے ننگا ہونے کا فکر ہوگا نہ دوسرے کا پتہ ہوگا, ہوش ہی نہیں ہوگی. اور پھر اللہ سبحانہ تعالیٰ اپنے فضل و کرم سے لوگوں کے جسموں کو ڈھانک دے گا, یعنی ابتدان اٹھایا جائے گا, لیکن اس وقت کیفیت ایسی ہوگی کہ ایسی گھبراہٹ ہوگی اور ایسی ہولناکی ہوگی کہ کسی کو اپنے ننگا ہونے تک کا علم نہیں ہوگا تو دوسرے کی کیا خبر. اللہ سبحانہ تعالیٰ اس دن میں ہمیں امن اور سکون عطا فرمائے, اپنے عرش کا سایہ نصیب فرمائے, اور سرکار دو عالم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے لواء الحمد کے تلے اللہ سبحانہ تعالیٰ سب کو جگہ عطا فرمائے. سو دس از دا اسٹینڈرڈ آف پراسپیرٹی دیٹ ریلیٹڈ ٹو دس دنیا is futile, just like this dunya is futile, because nothing will go with you. You can work all your life, you can build yourself a mansion, you can buy yourself the most expensive cars, you can build a bank balance of millions, eventually nothing will go with you. Everyone will die. That's an absolute, if there's one universal truth in the world, even the existence of God is disputed. Not everybody believes in God. People believe different things about God, you know, their deities and their gods. Not everyone believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one true God and Khalid. But if there is one thing which is undisputed reality in the world, that is the reality of death. Everyone and everything will perish. The fact is that if you know, everything that you've built, what happens to it when you die? You're going to leave it behind. Your debts will be paid off, and everything else that remains, that will be distributed amongst your inheritance. That becomes their wealth. And then they will use it up. If there's anything left when they die, the same thing will happen to them. Their debts will be paid off, and the rest that remains will be distributed amongst their inheritance. So people who have prosperity, with the standard of prosperity that we have set for ourselves, when they leave this dunya, they leave behind wealthy inheritance. Somebody's a millionaire, he dies, he leaves behind wealthy inheritance. He doesn't inherit, he doesn't take anything with him. You know, those who historically have tried to take things with them, what's happened? You know, the ancient Egyptians who buried their gold and their wealth and other ancient cultures that buried things with them, what happened to them? In fact, a worse fate than anyone else. Their graves were dug up, their remains desecrated, and everything that was there was taken from their graves. So they weren't even left, their graves were not left intact with the dignity of being left intact, even in the dunya. That's those who tried to take the dunya with them. جنہوں نے ساتھ لے جانے کی کوشش کی ان کو تو اتنی بھی اللہ سبحانہ تعالیٰ نے عزت نہیں عطا فرمائی کہ ان کی قبروں کی ہی حفاظت ہو جاتی. قبروں تک کو اکھیڑ دیا گیا, ان سے سارا کچھ نکال لیا گیا, لے کے بھی جائیں گے جو وہاں خالی ہاتھ ہی ہوتے. Not even the clothes on their back. So this standard of prosperity that everybody has set themselves, and remember one thing that you mentioned here, that the Prophet ﷺ said, in reality Your wealth is the wealth that you either spend on yourself in this dunya that you have eaten or that you have given in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which will be preserved for you in the akhirah. Everything else, nothing belongs to you. It belongs to your inheritors. Tera maal wo hai jo tumne kha liya ya aage bhej diya. Baki to tere urasa ka hai. Wo tera maal nahi hai. So this is something that we need to pay specific attention to. We have set our standard of prosperity way below where it's supposed to be. We're not using the correct gauge for prosperity. The gauge that we're using is something that will cease to exist the moment that we cease to exist. The prosperity that continues is that which will be effective in the akhirah. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the coming 9 verses. So this gate of prosperity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Qad aflaha al-mu'minun." The believers have prospered. Why have they prospered? "Ulaika humul warithun." Because they are inheritors. They've not left behind people that are going to inherit from them. They've not made their family, their inheritors, wealthy. They may have, right? But that's not been their priority, it's not been their focus. And in fact, many of them you will find may have gone from this dunya absolutely penniless. You have one person who's built a huge multi-billion pound empire, and he's gone from this world. If he's used the wrong gauge, then that's it, that's the end of everything. And he will be resurrected without the clothes on his back on the Day of Judgment, with the only thing, the only currency that will be availed and will be used there is the currency of deeds. And he may find himself completely bankrupt. But those who have the correct gauge for prosperity are those who leave the dunya, regardless of whether they have left behind wealthy inheritors or not. The reward for them is that they will be raised on the Day of Judgment, and they themselves, Allah declares, are inheritors. They've not left behind inheritors, they have become inheritors. On a day when everybody is raised with nothing in their hands, empty-handed, Allah says, these people have inherited. On that day, their hands will be full with their inheritance, which is what? It is Jannatul Firdaus. Not just Jannah, but the highest station in Jannah, where all the rivers, the Prophet said that Jannatul Firdaus is the highest rank in Jannah. Whenever you ask Allah for Jannah, ask Him for Jannatul Firdaus. This is where all the rivers and streams of Jannah actually begin from and flow into the other gardens. And so, Allah says they will become inheritors. Now there's a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses that term inheritors and not residents. That's a very interesting point. Ye badi khas pate ki baat hai ki Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ye ko farmaya ulaika humul warithun ki ye wo jannat ke waris hain. Jannat mein basne wale kyun nahi kaha? To ye ek badi khas baat hai ki jannat unko virasat mein kis tarah milegi. Ya is virasat se murad kya hai, to ispe inshallah aage baat hogi. We will talk about that, we will come to that verse. We will talk about what, how they become inheritors rather than residents of Jannah, and why Allah refers to them as inheritors rather than residents of Jannah. And I'm going to close that discussion there for today. So, few things that we've picked up today. First of all, with regards to surah, the name Al-Mu'minun is related to for the use of that word in the first verse, Qad aflaha al-mu'minun. And we know that the name of this surah has been used in this way in a hadith. And so that's why we know that this is one of the names of this surah. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala, his hadith mentions that the Prophet recited Surah al-Mu'minun in Fajr Salah. So we know that it's used in hadith in that way. In regarding the virtues of this hadith, The trees of Jannah, when they were created and Allah commanded them to speak, they spoke and they said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. They recited this word. This was there. You know, look at it. It's, how amazing is that? The trees of Jannah created and they said, the believers have prospered. And who are those believers? They are those same believers who will inherit those same trees in Jannah. So, how the ending and the beginning are actually joined together. And then the hadith of Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, which doesn't just end with kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, that his conduct was the Qur'an, but in fact, she recites those 10 verses and says this was the conduct of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But regarding the revelation of this surah, there is some element of dispute and, you know, there's some questions around the time of revelation of this surah. But with Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala narrating about this surah being recited in Makkah, it tells us that this surah was revealed before the Hijrah and after Sayyidina Umar accepted Islam, which is between the 6th and the 13th year. And then finally we had a look at the translation and we looked at that first verse, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and the fact that prosperity, you know, prosperity is some, it means different things to different people. The very first thing that we need to do is you need to set your gauge of prosperity right and get it correct. If you're using the wrong gauge, then none of the subsequent directions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have any effect for you. And so inshallah tomorrow we'll continue with verse number 2. Alladheena hum fi salatihim khashi'un, those who have khushu. The correct Arabic term is khushu, those who have sincerity in their prayer. Sincerity is just an equivalent word that I'm using. In reality, there's an explanation behind what khushu actually means. I can't just translate it into one word. And so inshallah we'll be looking at what khushu and sincerity actually means, how we can rectify our prayers, how we can get the most out of our prayers, and how we too can experience that halawa and sweetness in our prayers which our predecessors experienced and perhaps attain some of that sweetness of iman that they had. وَآخُرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ اللَّهُمَّ صَلِّ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدِنَا مَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَىٰ آلِ سَيِّدِنَا مَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَبَارِكَ وَسَلِّمَ. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار.
آمين.
وادخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا ربي ورحمن رب العالمين.
آمين.
ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان.
آمين.
ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا.